The grand sound of an organ you just can't hear from any other instrument. Thank you so much for playing. I did neglect one very important task today. We are always delighted when our preachers for the day are able to bring their wives with them, and Mary Cox is with us, sitting here with my wife, Rhonda. Welcome, Mary. And this is a very special time because it is the last day of her life she is ever going to be this young again. Tomorrow is her birthday. And so I wonder, Dr. Woodward, if we could sing Happy Birthday to Miss Mary. Now, Frank, I need to give you a word of warning.
Okay.
I'm going to feed you and Mary today, but that does not count for her birthday dinner tomorrow. All right? So remember that. So, Mary, we do love you. Thank you so much for coming. And let's join together in singing Happy Birthday
to Mary. All right, everybody say it.
Happy birthday to you.
Well, I tell you what, that was worth the trip to hear her happy birthday sung to her. And I hope that counts for something, Mary. I really do. I want you to invite you to take the Word of God today, and I want you to turn me to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18. Let me just say, I love Dr. Kelly, and I love them dearly, and I love the faculty. Some of them, I think there's still one or two that's on faculty that was here when I was a student here. And I want you to know that I've had some great experiences in this chapel. It was one of those things when we'd come on Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, that chapel was very meaningful to me in my life. And I made some real decisions when I was sitting out there. And God was real to me. On Tuesday, they usually brought a preacher in that would just talk about pastoral ministries, pastoral work. And on Wednesday, they bring, a professor to get up and share something that was really unique about the Word of God. On Thursday, they would bring another preacher in, and I wrote everything he said because it was Thursday and Sunday was coming, and I needed a sermon, all right? And Greg, it's good seeing you again. I was up at Truett McConnell College, led music in my church on a couple occasions, and Michelle, right? And I asked them if they got the Georgia clay out of their toes. They said they'd never got it out of their clothes. But great job this morning. Let me tell you what I want to do today. Dr. Kelly, with your permission, I want to preach something God's just laid on my heart. And a few weeks ago, I was in Moscow. They call it Moscow there, Russia. And I've been there twice now between New Year's Day and January the 7th. I usually go for about 10 days. And the reason I like to go during that time of year is because I'm not a wimp. And I don't know why any preacher would go during the summertime when they can go in the dead of winter over in Russia. And so I went this time to speak to all the missionaries. And we were having a retreat about 2 hours by train out of Moscow. And all of a sudden, God said, I want you to preach this message. I've only preached it twice before. And it was in my church. And I told God, I don't have the message with me. And God said, you figure it out, but I want you to preach this message. And so I emailed my secretary overnight. And the next night, or when I got up by morning time, she had emailed me this message. And when I got there to the retreat hour where I was supposed to speak that day, I told the missionaries, don't understand why God wants me to do this, but I'm going to speak on this subject. And yesterday, when I got on the plane to fly down, God said, I want you to preach it tomorrow. I don't know why. And the reason I don't know why is because, you see, they were missionaries. And they were giving their life to serve God in a great way on a foreign soil. And I don't understand why you, because you're students studying for ministry. Some of you are active in ministry right now, whether it's paid or whether it's volunteer. And I don't know why God wants me to preach this message today, but he's laid on my heart. I want you to look at the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18. And I want you to go down, if you will, to verse 21. And here it is that Simon Peter came to Jesus. And here's what he said. Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? And Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded him that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. And the servant, therefore, fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. And then the master of that servant was moved with compassion and released him and forgave him the debt. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. And he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. And when his fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. And then his master, after he had called him, said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? And his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due him. So my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. I want to say something to you today, and I want you to take it to heart. Someone asked me one time, said, how in the world do you stay in a church for 31 years? My only church out of seminary. I want you to know that I went there. It was running about 100 in Sunday school. Yesterday, or Sunday, we had somewhere right at 1,700 in Sunday school, 2,500 in worship. And you sit there and they ask you the question, how do you stay at a church? Why is it that the average stay in the Southern Baptist Convention today is that ministers move about every 18 to 24 months? And then you come upon some bird like me and they ask, how do you stay somewhere for 31 years? You see, the way that you stay somewhere is that you've got to learn that somewhere in your life that you've got to not only read the Word of God, but you've got to live the Word of God. That you've got to practice the Word of God. That it's not something that you give intellectual exercise to during the week and then on Sunday you get up and regurgitate what you have studied during the week, and then move on to next Sunday's sermon. But it's something that when you proclaim it from the pulpit, you begin to practice it with your life. And so, you know, I want you to understand something, and I don't mean to be a downer for you today, because that's not my intent of coming down here, but I want you to understand that if you're in ministry and you're working with people somewhere along your journey, you're going to be hurt in ministry. Someone is going to say something that's just going to knock you upside the head. Someone in a business meeting is going to take a big pole and just run it through your gut. Someone is going to come along in your life, and out of nowhere, they're going to just bring it down on you, if I can put it that way. And let me tell you something else that's going to surprise you. And it's usually going to be someone who is very close to you. It's going to be that deacon that was your cheerleader. It's going to be that chairman of the pastor search committee that called you to that church, or the chairman of the personnel team that brought you to serve in that fellowship. It's going to be that secretary that works in the office. It's going to be someone that's very close to you. But everyone who ever engages in ministry, somewhere in their life, they get hurt. Now, here's what you've got to understand. You've got to understand that if you're going to minister to them, then you've got to learn how to forgive them. And you've got to learn that that pain comes when they hurt you, but even greater pain comes when you do not forgive those who hurt you. And you see, I learned that the hard way at my church. When I first went there, I came from the bayous of southeast Louisiana. I was pastoring down at Barry Terry Baptist Church. That the first Sunday I was there, we ran nine. And then in 2.5 years, 3 years when I left to go to my church where I've served since then, I want you to know that, that God had blessed, and we were seeing many Catholics come to know Christ as Lord and Savior. And the church was filled, and our theme song was Victory in Jesus. And oh, if you want to get a bunch of Cajuns singing Victory in Jesus. And then we go to my church now, North Metro, but then it was Pleasant Hill, and there was not much pleasant on the hill. And I got there, and I began to preach Jesus, and all of a sudden, people began to get saved. And man, I thought I hit the mother load. And then all of a sudden, after about 2 years of being there, all of a sudden, all hell broke loose. People were sitting in other people's seats. All of a sudden, Dr. Kelly, I knew I was in trouble. One day when I was sitting on the second row, the front row, getting ready to preach, I was looking over my text, and I heard this sound. And I turned around, and there was a little lady with white hair who had lipstick where lips didn't go anymore, and she was looking at the family of five that was sitting there behind me that I had led to Jesus that week. And she informed them by tapping the side of the pew where there was a gold plaque, "You're sitting in my seat." They had bought that in memory of her husband when we were raising, when they were raising money for pews, and she thought that was really her seat. And I watched that family get up and go to the back row, and I watched them that day when I preached the gospel. I gave the invitation, and I looked at them, and they looked at me, but they did not move to come forward. And then a staff member disappeared on me, one of my best friends in life, brought him with me from seminary. Disappeared for 10 days, went out to California, had some kind of experience, came back, claimed he had amnesia, didn't know where he'd been, who he'd been with, what he'd been doing. And when that happened, my church erupted, and all of a sudden the pain began to come out. And all of a sudden the news media was there. And all of a sudden, my super buzzard Christians showed up at church. Do y'all know what that is? Those who never give, never serve, never come to church. When they smell blood down the church, they swoop in. Don't worry. When y'all get out of seminary, you'll meet them. And they came. And they voted me and the deacons and the personnel committee down on the termination of an immoral staff member. You talk about hurt. You talk about pain. Then all of a sudden, 3 weeks after that, I found out my first wife, Debbie, had a malignant brain tumor and was dying. And they came to me 4 months later and said to me, "We want your termination." They said, "You cannot be effective as a pastor because of your wife's brain tumor. You cannot be our pastor because you preach with power and anointing. You can't be our pastor because you're too good at reaching people in this community. You can't be our pastor because you talked about somebody in one of your sermons." They were right on that one. And do you know, I sat there and the pain was so real because these were people that I thought loved me. And all of a sudden, I found out something about my life that is true about your life, and that is when pain and suffering come to your life, if you're not careful, when someone hurts you, you imprison them in your dungeon. Every one of you got a dungeon. Every one of you got a room somewhere in your life. And what happens is that when someone comes along and hurts you, whether it be your mother, your dad, your brother, your sister, a fellow classmate, a professor, whoever it may be, you take them because you're so spiritual that you don't want to just work at it and and confront one another and deal with it to satisfy each other, that what you do is you take that person who has hurt you and you walk them down to the dungeon of your heart. And you take them in the room and you stretch out their hands and you handcuff them and they dangle in the dungeon of your life. And what happens is every now and then when you see them across the campus, or you see them at church, or you see them in your neighborhood, and you think about the hurt they have inflicted upon you, you go back down to your dungeon and you get out your whip and you start whipping at them. I remember what you did. I remember the hurt that you put in my life. I remember. And do you know what I had to learn in my own life? And that is that as long as I leave them in the dungeons of my life, that it doesn't impact them, it impacts me. And what I had to learn is that if I was going to be the man of God who stood in the pulpit and proclaimed about the forgiveness of God, then no matter what they did to me, I must learn how to forgive them. Whether they ever asked for it, whether they ever come to me and say, Frank, forgive me. Whether they ever came and sat there and said, Frank, I did this. Would you please forgive me? It was my responsibility to forgive them. I want you to write down two things very quickly today. The first thing is, I want you to see the perils of unforgiveness. Now, notice a scene right here in the Bible that we read a moment ago. Here was it, Simon Peter. He was all into this kingdom stuff. And he was listening to the words of Christ. And every time Christ would open up his mouth and teach, there was Simon Peter. And if he was in our day and time, he would have his laptop out. He would have his iPad out. He'd be typing all the notes in of the kingdom of God. And so Jesus started this thing about forgiveness, evidently. And Simon Peter, he came to Christ and said, he said, I've heard it said that you are to forgive what, Lord? Up to seven times. Now, you got to understand, in school, they'll teach you that seven is a specific number that means complete. And so Simon Peter was sitting there saying, Lord, if I forgive them seven times, I've done my responsibility right. And the Lord said, well, I think it's 70 times seven. I can see Simon Peter, because I'm just like Simon Peter. I begin to figure out in my mind, that means that I have to forgive them 490 times. But on that 491 time, I am going to bless them. And the Lord said, what I mean, Simon Peter, is you need to be a forgiver. You need to be one who not only receives grace, you ought to be one who gives grace. And you see, all of a sudden, when Christ begins to teach that way, the man in the text had a problem with unforgiveness. We see this. The very one who should have shown mercy was the very one who threw someone who had done him wrong into prison. Look at the problem that was there. The slave, the Bible says, owed a debt of 10,000 talents. Now, professors, I don't know whether it's correct or not, but one modern-day theologue said this. He said that could be as high as $50 million today. And so all of a sudden, you know, I went back and I computed on a wage of a slave back in that day. It would take that slave 4,500 lifetimes on a slave wage to pay back what he owed the king. And all of a sudden, the king says, you owe it to me. You need to pay it. And all of a sudden, the plea begins to come. And the slave begged for mercy. Oh, the king watched as that slave got down on his knees, and all of a sudden the slave said, if you'll just have mercy on me, I will pay it all back. And the king said, have him sold along with his wife, along with his family. Aren't you glad we don't live in that day? Because you see, the king was well within his right. He could take the whole family down and put them up on the slave blocks, and people could bid, and they could separate the family and send them all over the world of that day. And the king said, have him done that. And the man looked up and pleaded for mercy and said, O king, if you will, have mercy, and I will pay you back everything. And the Bible tells us that the king was moved with compassion as he looked at that man who was broken, and in humility he cried out for compassion. It's a glorious picture. Because you see, there's times in my own life that I find myself standing before a holy God, and I know I don't deserve the mercy and the grace of God. And yet when I cry out to God, I receive His mercy when He sees my brokenness and my humility and my repentance. And God forgives me. But look at the paradox here. That same slave who received mercy, he goes and finds another slave that owes him about $15. And the Bible tells us that that slave went and he grabbed that servant around the throat and he sat there and he says, I want you to pay it up. And then when you read on down the story, listen, now I'm going to give you Frank Cox's paraphrase, but it was the same identical words that the previous slave had begged the king with. Oh, if you'll just have mercy, I will pay you everything that I owe you. And that slave who had received mercy, who should have given mercy, said, I'll have no dealings with that. Take him and cast him into prison. You know, when I read that story several years ago, I was dealing with an unforgiving heart, not someone else's, but mine. You see, they used to break in my office. And they would take all my books and throw them in a pile on the floor, trying to intimidate me. They would break into my office at night and take Coca-Cola, and they would literally pour it down the line of the phone system to fry it, just to intimidate me. They would call me up and threaten me. They would come by my home late at night and blow horns for about an hour just to intimidate me. They would call me names in the business meetings at my church. I've got a tape that shows you how long ago it's been. I've got a cassette tape of one business meeting where they called me just about everything under the sun, all because they wanted to protect their church that was starting to grow. And everything I'd ever touched in ministry had turned to gold. I thought everybody loved Jesus. And now my heart was broken. My wife was dying. My church was fighting like cats and dogs. And people would come up and say just awful things. And I began to cry out to God, God, where are you in all of this? One man, we finally got to the point that we realized that two groups couldn't stay together. And so a group left. And the next Sunday I had to recruit teachers, and I walked into this class, and I said, we need some teachers. And this one heavyset man sat there and with a deep, gravelly, demonic voice said, well, you just ran off a bunch of them. Then he said, it's the last thing I do, I'm going to run you off. I would see that man, I'm not proud about what I'm about to tell you, but Chuck, I would see that man coming in the hallway, and I began a prayer ministry for that man. And I started asking God to do three things in that man's life. I asked God to move him, change him, and if he wasn't going to do those two, to kill him. Y'all didn't know preachers prayed that way, did you? And I kept praying those same three things. God, move him, change him, or kill him. Doesn't matter which one you do, just do one of them. And all of a sudden, one day I saw him coming in the hallway, and I told God, God, here's me and him. I'll take care of the third part. I'll just take his head off right here. And all of a sudden, one day I saw him coming in the hall, and he stopped, and I stopped. I said, how you doing? He said, I'm doing fine. How you doing, preacher? I said, I'm doing fine. And we walked on. I just kind of went, you know, what was that? And then another couple weeks went by, and I found myself walking down the same way that he was walking. And we were laughing together. And we had our arms around one another. And I don't know whether God changed that man or not, but I got a sneaking suspicion God changed me. And instead of wanting God to kill him, all of a sudden I realized that I understood justice, but I did not understand mercy and grace the way I should. And in my prayers, God began to show me that if I was ever going to be effective as a pastor, that I had to be willing to show mercy and grace to people that were hurting in their life. You see, I had to come to the path of forgiveness. And I want you, if you will, just to write down just three or four things here very quickly. And I know time is of essence. And I want you to understand that there is a process that God wants us to go through when somebody hurts us. The first one is this, is that you always base your forgiveness on what God has done for you rather than what the person has done to you. That is so important. Because, you see, we may think what the person did to us is too big for us to forgive. And whatever a person has done to us is insignificant when compared to the debt that you owe God. And I had to learn that. I had to learn that the principle of forgiveness is this, that I cannot give away something I haven't first received. And what you need to understand is that if I had $15 today, before I could ever give it to you, I must receive that $15. And when you have a hard time with mercy and forgiveness and grace in your ministry, it may be because there's something in your life that has stopped you from realizing what God has really done for you. He's given you mercy. He's given you grace. And if you have received it, then you ought to be some of the first to give it in ministry. Second thing I want you to write down is this, is that you must allow God to heal past wounds. You see, I don't know what has hurt you in the past, but when you don't allow God to heal your past hurts, you will continue to keep people locked up in your dungeon. And every now and then you'll go down late at night and take that whip out and you'll whip them some more and say, that's what you've done to me. Now some of you say, now Pastor, wait a minute. You don't know what they did to me. But I do know what the Word of God says. The Word of God tells me that the seed of unforgiveness will sprout into the root of bitterness in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 15. And what it says to me, that the hurt that we submerge within us becomes a landmine. And anytime somebody comes along in your ministry and they put the slightest pressure on that landmine, it explodes. And all of a sudden, you begin to react. You begin to respond in a fleshly way that usually results in the shortening of your ministry. Here's a third thing I want you just to write down. We need to feel compassion for the person who hurts us. You know, I had to learn how to do that. The king took compassion for the slave in verse 27. Forgiveness flows out of a compassionate heart instead of an angry heart. And what I had to learn in my own ministry was this, is that hurt people hurt people. You know what I learned? I learned that when somebody spews their venom at me, I've learned to quit balling my fist up and want to slug them back. Instead, I've had to stop and say, now what's really bugging that person? Where's the pain in their life? But Pastor, you don't know what they did. That person, that deacon, he said bad things about me when I was not there to defend myself. Well, you got to learn you can't defend yourself, that God is your defender. Second thing, Pastor, you don't understand. My dad, he abused me. Pastor, you don't understand. My mother, this is what she did to me when I was growing up. Pastor, you just don't understand. Have you got a family member that always wears their feelings right here? All of us do. I got one sister. It's right there. Every time we get together for Christmas, the bet in our family was who knocks it off the first, the quickest. She's waiting. She's prying. She wants to spew venom. She wants to knock your head off. She wants to destroy the Christmas gathering. And so we just started saying, well, let's just go ahead and get it out of the way when we first get there, and then we can enjoy Christmas. Y'all got a family member like that? Until one day, I started looking at my sister through the eyes of Jesus. And you go back and study Jesus. Every time he saw somebody, and the Bible says he had compassion, Jesus started seeing them for the real needs that were there in their life. And that person who stirs a stinking business meeting, that person who says bad things about you, let me just tell you what they are. They're hurt people. And hurt people will hurt people. Here's the fourth thing I want you to write down. We choose to pay off the debt the person owes us. That's what the scripture is all about right here. The king, not only did he forgive the debt, he erased it. He took on the responsibility of the debt himself. And the fifth thing I would tell you is stop replaying the hurt in your mind. And the last thing I'd tell you is, and release the person from your dungeon. I want you to close your Bibles just for a moment. I want you just to bow your head just for a second or two. And here's what I want to do in this closing moment before I pray. Have you ever been hurt? Then my question is, who's in the dungeon of your life? Who is it in your ministry? Who is it at this stage in your life that you've got tied up, hung up, strung up in the dungeon of your life? That father who may have abused you, that mother who was so mean, that classmate who did you wrong, that professor that didn't give you the grade you thought you should have got, whatever you got caught up in, and you've taken those people and you've hung them up in your dungeon. I want to ask you today to understand that your ability to forgive will determine your success in ministry. I don't care what pastor you talk to. I don't care what successful minister that you may say, now that guy's got it together. I want you to know you go and talk to each and every one of them, and they're going to tell you about deep pain in their life. And they're going to talk about people who have hurt them and how they had to learn to forgive them in order to minister to them. So how do you set the people free? Well, first of all, just make the list of the people that you got hung up in your dungeon. Second thing is this. Recall Jesus just didn't die for your sins. He also died for that person who has hurt you sin. And right now, individually, I want you to, in that dungeon of your heart, I want you to take that key and unlock that handcuff. And I want you to look at that person in the eye, in your mind, and I want you to say, I forgive you. I set you free. Now listen carefully. I want you, last of all, to destroy the mental tape that continuously plays in your mind, that Satan makes sure he always plays the play button. And I want you, and every time Satan goes to push that play button, say to him, Satan, don't do that. I've already forgiven that person. I've given them grace and mercy. They're set free in my life. Now look at me. That man that I wanted to knock his head off, I got called one day to come to his house. I was getting ready to leave to go to Russia for the first time back several years ago. And when I went to Ralph's house, I looked at him, and he looked at me. He was laying in a hospital bed. He was about to die from cancer. And he looked at me and said, Frank, I want you to know, when you first came, I didn't like you. And I looked at him and said, Ralph, I knew that. Everybody in the church knew that. He looked at me and said, but I got a problem. I said, what's your problem? He said, I'm dying, and you're going to Russia. And he says, what am I going to do if I die while you're in Russia? He says, you're my prince of preachers. He said, nobody's going to bury me but you. Man, what a difference God makes when you give mercy and you give grace. Let's pray. Lord, I don't know why I preach this today. And Lord, it may not be homiletically correct. It may not get an A+ in preaching lab. It just... may not. But Lord, I always marvel in your sovereignty. And Lord, there's somebody here today who need to hear that. And Lord, it may be some sweet girl sitting here that, Lord, that's been carrying a load for a long time, that her past has not been pleasant. And she's got people tied up. She just needs to set them free. Lord, it may even be that there may be a professor who's sitting here today, that, Lord, that there may be something there in their life that somebody has hurt them, and Lord, they've tied them up in a dungeon in their life. And Lord, what's keeping them from being exactly who they desire to be in you, Boy, that unforgiving spirit may be stopping them. Lord, would you set them free? Lord, it may be a ministration. Lord, it may be just someone who's just wandered in here today. But Lord, I know one thing. Your word never comes back void. And I know you're sovereign God. And I know you're King. We've sung about that today. And Lord, we've already sung about you're worthy because of your forgiveness and the nail-pierced hands. Lord, I pray that whoever's got a dungeon will set those people free so that they can be successful in ministering in your name. In Jesus' name. And all the people say, amen. Thank y'all.